Hi guys, so today I am going to solve a problem on design of percolation tank. In the previous class we had discussed a few topics of design of percolation tank, so let's have a small overview of that. So design of percolation tank requires selection of suitable site for percolation tank. So after you select a suitable site for percolation tank, we need to calculate the catchment area, and from that catchment area, on the virtue of rainfall falling over that area depending upon the monsoon rainfall, so it is to be classified as good catchment area, average catchment area and bad catchment area depending upon the rainfall happening in that particular area. So this is a theme that is adapted from Strange's table. That means the Strange's table classifies a catchment area into good catchment area, average catchment area and bad catchment area depending upon the rainfall occurring over there. So from that Strange's table, the catchment area can be computed. That means, for example, if we just have a look at it, on the Strange's table, it consists of total monsoon rainfall happening in inches and total monsoon rainfall happening in mm. It is converted, so again it consists of percentage of runoff into a rainfall. That means a good catchment area have a good amount of runoff compared to average and bad catchment. So depending upon that, we can calculate the catchment yield basically. So after calculating the catchment yield, so we have to make some suitable assumptions. So suitable assumptions means the how much water is to be utilized per year. So but before going to further design of earthen embankment, let us see why it is very much important to build or construct an earthen embankment. So I'll just draw a small figure having or which will help us to understand the concept better. So let us see. So there will be a ridge, a hill kind of there will be hills and there will be ridge lines where the water will fall as rainfall from the atmosphere and it further goes as runoff. So our motto is to percolate the water into the groundwater reserves. So this can be considered as the earthen embankment. So this earthen embankment is constructed to store the water. So what is the purpose of storage of water? The percolation. The water is made to percolate into the groundwater reserves, so which is available for farmers in terms of water in the wells, which can be utilized later for irrigation and domestic purpose. So this is basically the motto of construction of earthen embankment. Okay, so I'll just write few terms over here. So rainfall occurs and we have runoff and we have earthen embankment constructed. So earthen embankment is constructed through consolidation of earthen materials available locally. So then the percolation happens through into the groundwater reserves, and it is available as groundwater resource in the downstream. So this area is called upstream. So this area is called downstream. So the motto for this kind of system, which we called as percolation tank, is nothing but to recharge the groundwater. Okay, now after understanding this concept, let us have a small look of the components of the earthen embankment. So earthen embankment will be having a upstream wrapped with stone pitching and gravel layer and downstream open to atmosphere. So earthen embankment will be having an upstream of water which will be having full reservoir level, high flood level, and after that we will be having a freeboard. Okay, freeboard means it is open to atmosphere. So beyond high flood level, the freeboard is given to, you know, to save the embankment from sliding or any devastation, because the hydrostatic pressure is too much high in this earthen embankment, and this earthen embankment is also having a impervious clay core, so which avoids the seepage of water through the earthen embankment. So it is having a very gradual upstream slope and a very normal downstream slope. So, and the earthen embankment is made of materials of pervious material. So you can see the saturation line is cut off by the cone of core of impervious clay. So the downstream is also having some tap filter and filter of made of concrete and other stuff. So we also have horizontal floor, so which is given to avoid the seepage of water through the earthen embankment, because we do not want the water to percolate through the embankment, because we are supposed to make the earthen embankment very stable. So after learning about these components, so basically what we are supposed to do, we are supposed to calculate ideal high flood level or ideal full tank level for storage purposes, depending upon the availability of rainfall in that particular area. So basically we are supposed to design this earthen embankment in this particular class. So there are various formulae to calculate freeboard, settlement, top width of the embankment, length of the embankment. So depending upon the material, we are going to give the upstream slope and downstream slope. We have a table which will provide us a better assumption of having upstream slope depending upon the type of material and downstream slope depending upon the type of material. So we are going to calculate the peak discharge. So why peak discharge is required? Peak discharge is required to calculate the length of surplus wear. So why surplus wear is very much important? Surplus wear is important for accommodating the flood water, because the flood water is required to take off from the site, because if the flood water increases more than the high flood level, there will be a possibility of breach in the earthen embankment. To accommodate that, we have to design a surplus wear. Surplus wear means extra water wear, so it will remove the surplus water from the wear. So we have to calculate the peak discharge. Peak discharge means it is the flood discharge. So the length of surplus wear depends upon the peak discharge. So the width of horizontal and length of horizontal floor is designed in such a way that the saturation line, and we also have to calculate the length of the total length of the earthen embankment, and to make sure that the saturation line is well accommodated before the total length of the embankment. Let's note on the data that is given in the problem. So but before that, we will draw a small diagram of embankment, earthen embankment, that we are going to consider for designing in this particular problem, because it will give us a fair good idea. So this can be treated as a water level, so this can be treated as bottom of the embankment. So let us see the data one by one. So the catchment area is provided as 21 hectares. So data is given as 21 hectares. Intensity of rainfall. Is equal to 17 centimeter per hour. RL of ground surface. RL of ground surface is equal to 100 meters. That means the RL of this value is equal to 100 meters. So RL of HFL. So RL of HFL is equal to 103 meters. That means this particular level is 103
103 meters.
So runoff coefficient is given as
coefficient is given as 0.3. Soil type is sandy loamy soil.
So soil type is sandy loamy soil. So slope of saturation line,
slope of saturation line is equal to 4:1. So assume a fetch of 500 meters.
Fetch length, that is the longest exposed water surface on the reservoir. That means the longest distance up to which the water surface is visible from the reservoir, that means from the embankment, is to be assumed. So here in the problem, it is being assumed as 500 meters. So we can start solving the problem. So we have to step by step calculate the various parameters. So here is a slide which help us to, you know, follow to solve the problem and design the earthen embankment. So basically we have to calculate the height of water up to HFL.
So how to calculate the height of water up to HFL? So height of water up to HFL is equal to 103 meters minus 100 meters. So which is nothing but 3 meters. So this is height of water up to HFL.
Height of water up to HFL. So we have to calculate height of waves.
So there are, you know, there is waves hitting the earthen embankment. So for that we have formula to calculate height of waves, that is HW is equal to 0.014 dm to the power of 0.5. so dm is nothing but 500 meters, that is fetch length. So we have to substitute it over here. HW is equal to 0.014 500 to the power of 0.5. so HW will be equal to 0.31, so that is 0.014 into 500 to the power of 0.5 will give you a value of 0.31 meters.
So next is we have to calculate freeboard. So we have to calculate freeboard. Freeboard F is equal to 1.5 times the height of waves. So that is 1.5 times into 0.31, because we have got height of waves as 0.31. So this will give us 0.46 meters. This 1.5 into 0.31 will give you 0.465 meters. So we have to basically next calculate the, you know, allowance for settlement. So before we calculate allowance of settlement, that means the what is the consolidations allowed, consolidation percentage allowed, we have to basically calculate the height of embankment up to now. Height of embankment is equal to height up to HFL plus freeboard, which is nothing but 3 plus 0.46, which is 3.46. so this doesn't include consolidation. So we have to assume 5% consolidation or allowance for settlement. That means The earthen embankment, since it is made up of earthen materials locally available, so it is tend to consolidate or it tend to settle for around 5% after its construction. That means we can take it as a effective height only after we consider allowing the settlement or allowing the consolidation. So basically what we are supposed to do is we are supposed to calculate the consolidated height. That means it amounts up to 5%. What is 5%? It is nothing but 5 by 100. 5 by 100 into the considered height over here right now into 3.46, so which will give us a value of 5 by 100 into 3.46, so 0.17 meters. So this is the consolidation height. So basically what we have to do is we have to consider width, the height of embankment. So this will give us the total height of embankment. Is equal to 3.46 plus 0.17. So this will give us a value of 3.46 plus 0.17. So this is give us a value of 3.63 meters. So this is total height of the embankment. So what is the next step? So our next step is to calculate the top width of embankment. That means after total height, we have to calculate the top width of embankment. So this is capital H and this is capital W. So how to calculate top width of embankment? It is nothing but H by 5 plus 1.5. so this will give us a value of 3.63 divided by 5 plus 1.5. So this will give us 2.226, or 2.23 we can consider. 2.23 I can consider as top width of embankment. So depending upon the soil type, we have to consider the upstream slope and downstream slope. So here the soil is considered as sandy loamy soil. So let us see what is the upstream and downstream slope being considered for sandy loamy soil. So for sandy loamy soil, it is considered as the last one in the table. So it is considered as 3:1 for upstream, 2.5:1 for downstream slope. That is 3 horizontal, 1 vertical, 2.5 horizontal and 1 vertical. That is 3:1. Downstream slope is 2.5:1. So this is what we are going to consider for embankment. So we are done with considering the upstream and downstream slope from the table, that is 3:1 and 2.5:1. So what's our next step? Next step is to calculate the peak discharge. So for peak discharge, we have formula. Peak discharge Q is equal to CIA by 36, where the catchment area is considered in hectares, intensity of rainfall is considered in centimeter per hour, and area is considered and runoff coefficient is considered 0.3. so we shall substitute everything. 0.3 is the runoff coefficient, and intensity of rainfall is 17, and area is in hectares, that is 21, whole thing divided by 36. So Q will be 2.975. So peak discharge is nothing but 2.975 meter cube per second. So using this peak discharge, we have to calculate length of spillway. So this is length of surplus sphere. That means length of
it's nothing but length of spillway L is equal to Q by C into H to the power of 3 by 2.
So here C is nothing but the constant that we have to consider from the formula. C is equal to constant 1.674 broadcasted wave. So here we are going to calculate the length of spillway for the design of broadcasted wave. So C will be considered as 1.67. Length of the weir is to be calculated, height of the flow height above the weir. So we are considering it as 0.3 meters.
So let us substitute 2.975 over here, which is peak discharge divided by constant, which is nothing but 1.67 for this is constant for broadcasted weir into head is considered as 0.3 meters whole to the power of 3 by 2. So we can calculate this 2.975 divided by 1.67 into 0.3 all to the power of 3 by 2 or 1.5. So we'll be getting an answer of 10.84 meters, because length is nothing but should be kept in meters. 10.84 meters. So till now we have calculated length of spillway. Okay, so our next step is to calculate the width of horizontal floor. So to calculate the width of horizontal floor, we need the formula. So we need to calculate the width of horizontal floor. So to calculate width of horizontal floor, we are in requirement of formula. So let us have a peek of the formula. So width of horizontal floor with a vertical drop from the foot of the drop wall to the downstream edge should not be less than 2 of d plus h. That means 2 of d plus h. So the minimum value should be 2 of d plus h. So here, what is d? So d is nothing but height of the drop, and h is nothing but head of water over the wall. So I'll just give a small picture. So this is our embankment. Somewhere we'll be having some amount of length, and here we are going to give a surplus weir, correct? No, surplus weir, which will take out the extra water. So this is at a height of 3 meters. So here d is equal to 3 meters. That means height of the drop wall. So depending upon that, and head above the water, head above the weir, it is considered as 0.3 meters. Like in the previous calculation, we have considered maximum head should be taken as 0.3 meters for the surplus weir. So here we have to substitute that only. 2 of, so d is considered as 3 meters, h is considered as 0.3. 2 of 3 plus 0.3, that is 2 of 3.3. It is nothing but 6.6 meters. So width of horizontal floor should be given minimum 6.6 meters. Width of the horizontal floor for the surplus weir. So let us see what is the next width of rough stone apron that should be given for talus of the last wall of the wall. So this is W1 for the surplus weir. This is W2. So this W2 is calculated by using the formula 4 of d plus h, which is nothing but 4 of 3 plus 0.3 is equal to 13.2. So 13.2 meters. So width of horizontal floor for masonry wear is 6.6, and width of horizontal floor for rough stone apron is 13.2 meters. So basically now we have to calculate actual length of saturation line. Why we need to calculate the actual length of saturation line? Because we have to locate the saturation line for checking stability. So how to calculate the length of saturation line? By having the picture like this. So we know that we have water HFL for a depth of 3 meters, and upstream slope is 3:1, downstream slope is 2.5:1, and the top width of the embankment is W is equal to W is equal to 2.23 meters. So we need all these values to compare the actual length of stream line, saturation line, whether it is passing through the base of the base of the embankment, or is it is going beyond. See, if it is satisfying or if it is passing behind or before the base of the length of the base of the embankment, it is safe. If this line goes beyond like this, then it is very sure that it is going to break or breach the embankment. So we are going to calculate the actual length of saturation line. So how to calculate then? So we have to calculate with the formula having a value of so basically we have to calculate the upstream length of the saturation line. So this is 3 meter of water, and upstream ratio of horizontal line or upstream slope of the water surface is 3. That is, we have to take 3 into 3. So what is the slope of the saturation line? It is 4:1. That is, slope of the saturation line is it is 4:1. Okay, that means this height of water is having a ratio between 3 in upstream, and downstream it is having a ratio of 4. 3 into 3 plus height of water into 4. So this will give us the length of actual length of saturation line. So let us calculate. 3 into 3 is 9, 3 into 4 is 12. So actual length of saturation line is 21 meters. So if we calculate length of base of embankment, we will be having a clear picture whether the actual length of saturation line is going beyond or behind the behind the base of the embankment. So how to calculate that? So we know that the width of the top width of the embankment is 2.23 meters. This is W is equal to 2. Since the top width of the embankment can be represented for the bottom or the base, this particular portion should be calculated. So how to calculate the upstream length of the base and downstream length of the base? So upstream length of the base and downstream length of the base can be calculated by using the upstream slope and downstream slope. That is 3.63 total height of the embankment into upstream slope plus top width of the dam plus 3.63 which is total height of the embankment into downstream slope will give us the value of 22.195 or 22.2 meters, which is actual length of the base of the embankment. But what is actual length of the saturation line? Which this is 21 meters. That means the 21 meters of actual length of saturation line is coming behind the total length of the base of the embankment. That means the saturation is trying to seep within the base of the embankment, which makes the actual structure safe. If it goes beyond the embankment, then definitely the embankment will be made into two half. That means the bottom of the embankment will definitely slide, it will definitely erode. So what makes the structure stable? If the actual length of the saturation line is less than that of the length of the base of the embankment, hence the embankment is stable or the structure is safe. So here the problem is concluded.